So let's start with a quote. We basically have been talking about the future of Hadoop for the last 13 years, ever since the first patch went in that basically made it Hadoop and made it separated from Nudge and Lucene. But the future that we used to talk about over the last 13 years, it's not what it used to be. It's not what it is now, right? So obviously, just to sort of recap where we all got started about 13, 14, 15 years ago, I would say, with the Google papers, GFS, MapReduce, obviously you know the history. Where we got started with Hadoop at Yahoo was that in 2003, Yahoo acquired two companies, among many others, Ink2Me and Overture, and that basically became Yahoo Search after the integration of those two. And the back end of that Yahoo Search was powered by something by the Ink2Me infrastructure, and that was led by Eric Bolschweiler. So the project that was launched in the middle of 2005 was something called W1W, right? So we basically had PageRank-like computations in Yahoo Search. It used to be called web map. The web map, obviously, because the web was growing, the web map was growing, and the existing infrastructure for web map, which was called Dreadnought, which was not scaling. It was at its peak at around 600 machines. So the goal of the W1W project was essentially to launch or compute this web map in 1 week, right? And at the scale at which the web was growing. So the project was launched in 2005, middle of 2005. It was called Juggernaut. And Ink2Me had this habit of naming their projects like very destructive things, you know, so Dreadnought, Juggernaut, Kryptonite, etc. So that was essentially the thing. So as part of that project, we basically started working on Juggernaut file system, Juggernaut MapReduce, and for job scheduling, etc. We had selected a project, an academic project from Wisconsin called Condor. Right, so we worked on that for about 6 months and then abandoned when we started working on Hadoop. All right, so in parallel, inspired by the Google file system and MapReduce papers, a person by the name of Doug Cutting basically had started these two projects called Lucene and Nudge. And in the deep in the bowels of Nudge was this thing called NDFS and NMR. So a Nudge distributed file system and Nudge MapReduce. So basically, we abandoned our JFS and JMR and in favor of the NDFS and NMR. Because Yahoo Search was a proprietary search engine, we could not contribute legally to open source search engine. Otherwise, we would have to wait for 5 years just to get in front of the lawyers to get that permission. So we basically convinced Doug to get Hadoop out of our HDFS or NDFS and NMR out of Lucene and Nudge and make it into a separate project so that Yahoo engineers could legally contribute to that. Right, so in 6 to 8 months, and this is the familiar picture that I think has appeared in various presentations, even some not even from Yahoo, saying that this is their Hadoop cluster. But this was the first Hadoop cluster that back in where Kaifer Road is today, used to be a Yahoo data center. It was called Kryptonite. This was the first Hadoop cluster at Yahoo. It was borrowed from the Ink2Me search team. This was their indexer cluster before, right? So what was the Hadoop future in 2006 that we used to talk about, right? Hadoop was essentially the savior for Yahoo, and it was actually going to help Yahoo win the search engine wars that were going on at that time between Google, Yahoo, and at that time, MSN Search. It wasn't branded Bing at that time, right? We all know what happened. I'm not going to go there. All right, but the lessons that we learned during that time, I think still stick with us in the Hadoop community, in general, in the data infrastructure, right? So first thing is, when you are designing a data platform, you need to design it with multi-tenancy from ground up. When you basically have, you know, we started with Hadoop on demand, we basically tried to scale the job tracker and all these things only when MapReduce was the only programming paradigm, and then it basically moved on to YARN and things like that. But grafting multi-tenancy in the platform after the fact is extremely difficult, right? Second thing is, don't focus on the bare metal performance from the beginning. There were systems at Yahoo at that time, right? Even in 2005, right? That used to perform much better than Hadoop in 2006, 2007, right? So we basically gave up all those performance gains or performance experience that we had, but we gained agility as a result of that. The third thing is provision the hardware or provision the system. Do not procure it every time. Right, and this has now become such a common thing with the public clouds and things like that. It was really difficult to understand. Again, for the old timers, I don't know whether this still goes on or not. Friday, 8 a.m., the HRC meeting with David Filo. I've seen grown IT infrastructure managers cry in Yahoo for that meeting for procuring the hardware. Right, and I think one of the lessons that we learned is that it was much easier for those engineering projects within Yahoo to essentially come to the Hadoop team and saying, I need 100 machines once a week, something like that, rather than going to David Filo and asking for machines, right? So provisioning much, much frictionless than procurement. We were operating the cluster. It was not like earlier platforms in Yahoo where engineers will build the code and somebody else will run it, right? So we built the code in the entire Hadoop team and we operated the clusters as well. We helped with onboarding, we helped with porting existing applications and all those things, right? And kept a watch on what people were trying to do with this Hadoop infrastructure. We learned a lot, I would say, by how people were misusing Hadoop at that time rather than how people were using it, right? So using these weird use cases as a learning experience. And the fifth and the most important thing from my personal point of view is basically we had this M45 program, a cluster that was for academic clusters, academic usage. We collaborated with a lot of universities and we learned a lot from what the students were doing on these Hadoop clusters as well, right? One university where I would have personally like to have much more interaction, much more deeper collaboration, we did not have, and which was Berkeley. All right, so then we go into the 2011 to 2014 phase, which I basically call as the peak Hadoop hype. Because after 2014, when we went to Sandhill and mentioned Hadoop, they did not even let us in, right? 2011 to 2014 was the time where everybody was talking about Hadoop, okay? So you probably have seen some of these headlines, 2012 saying half of the world's data is going to somehow touch Hadoop. And then, first it became 2015, then it became 2017. I don't think it's still there, but those were the headlines at that time, right? From big names like Datanami and Gartner and everyone else, right? So, and these basically start sort of Hadoop's applicability or the market that Hadoop was trying to target at that time was slowly evolving, right? It was not only for search engines to compete against other search engines. It was basically becoming part of the analytical processes for any company. That's basically how Hadoop was basically being pushed or being projected at that time, right? So basically, this is a slide from one of my previous companies, Greenplum, where we basically said that, hey, guess what is happening today? You have all these data, structured, unstructured, all those things, and then all the numbers came in, 80% structured, 20% whatever, 80% unstructured, 20% structured, etc. You are dropping all these data, you are not deriving business insights from that, and the slow ETL processes are killing you, and therefore ETL should be called ELT, and all those things. And then slowly, you basically ingest all this data into Hadoop, right? What do you do with that was still not known, but you just put all this data in Hadoop. Someday you will, gain some benefit from that. So using Hadoop or HDFS in particular, as a cheaper Bitbucket is basically what was happening around that time, right? The third thing that we envisaged would happen, and this was back in 2011, is that, hey, somehow the business-friendly analytics engines will come in on top of Hadoop, and that will basically just make Hadoop into an enterprise data warehouse where you won't need these complex MPP architectures, appliances, and all these things. Did that happen? Well, one of the things that happened is that the MPP data warehouses that existed before Hadoop, basically, and charging exorbitant amount of money, their price points came down, right? I based on the research that I have done, I think this is directly correlatable to or directly related to the emergence of Hadoop in the analytics market space, right? So that's basically definitely a result of that. The data warehouses haven't gone anywhere, but Hadoop has augmented them most of the times, right? The third thing that basically got started is SQL everywhere, right? So basically with the MapReduce, we used to have, and I remember 2008, first Hadoop summit, we had an informal get together outside of the hall where this Hadoop summit was happening. And there was a nice debate going on, Olga might remember that, between Pig and Hive. Why bring in Hive? Why bring in SQL when nobody understands, engineers don't understand SQL? That was the argument. But somehow, over the last several years now, about 10 years, 2008 was the first Hadoop summit, SQL has come out everywhere. And you basically see, you know, everybody basically starts with some programmable Java interfaces, and then on top of that, add SQL, right? So we have already too many SQLs running on top of Hadoop. So in 2014, if you had to look at all the Hadoop marketing, Hadoop company marketing, right, basically been the, what is the future of Hadoop? Well, Hadoop is going to end the enterprise data warehouse as we know it. Hadoop is going to become the enterprise data warehouse. That was the future in 2014, right? What happened? Well, I think now that I look back, 2014 was the pivotal year in which Hadoop's future was disrupted. As we used to call, predict Hadoop's future, that was disrupted in 2014. Various reasons, companies who were supplying Hadoop had gone, were going public, and had one of them had gone public. And their goal was to have repeatable sales and all these, you know, the nice Wall Street terminology. And they wanted to make Hadoop as boring as possible for the littlest guy or girl running their data infrastructure, right? That was one, definitely. But the bigger impact on the direction of Hadoop, I think, came with clouds, both public as well as private clouds, right? Those were the biggest, the most impactful on the future of Hadoop. Essentially, what started happening around 2014, although AWS and internal cloud deployments within companies existed for ever since 2005, 2006, something like that, but really gained currency in the marketplace, I think, around 2014. When the CIO of Goldman Sachs went to AWS reInvent in 2015 and basically says, you know, you guys can do security much better than any of us on Wall Street would be able to do, that basically gave the public clouds the legitimacy in the enterprise infrastructure, right? The infrastructure as a service essentially became the new hardware, right? Again, easy provisioning came into picture. It was scalable, it was ubiquitous, it was elastic, and increasingly it came bundled with the data and analytics services, right? So that's basically the 2014 was the inflection point on that. This cloud-based data fabric, the cloud-based data fabric basically said, yeah, store all your massive databases. Again, the definition of massive and definition of scalability in this building as well as the buildings around here is very different than the buildings in New York, right? So their massive data sets, multiple terabytes, not petabytes yet, right? And very diverse data sets, basically meaning emails and stuff like that, right? You can analyze all of those economically, right? Integrate from all these legacy and disparate sources that you have within your enterprise, right? So ability to rapidly analyze this data basically did not mean that rapidly after provisioning, but the rapid part actually took into account the provisioning time as well. That's what made it really rapid. And in that case, that whole data locality that gives me the best performance when my compute and my storage are exactly on the same machines, that went away because it was not the job running time that basically became an important measure, but how fast can I spin up or provision the hardware in order to run that job or run that analytical workload, that became much more important. for those guys, right? And as a result, the compute local file systems got less and less important, and the rise of object stores essentially happened. All right. So now, in the 4 years that now we have seen that cloud has become the default platform for the enterprise to run their massive analytical workloads, and it is moving there. Right, applications have already started migrating to the public clouds. The analytics is slower to get there, but it is getting there. Right, and now there is another disruption point that we basically at least hear about from Sandhill and the Valley and the most successful companies in the Valley, which is that AI is going to disrupt everything. Right, so let me sort of start with a few disparaging tweets about AI, because it's again at the peak of its hype cycle, right? Most of the time when people say we are doing AI, it's basically, you know, slicing and dicing your data in various ways to plot them and to see what the curve of that graph basically looks like, right? However, if you basically see that AI, which is sort of a technique in machine learning, obviously most of the time still gets spent in getting the right data and analyzing it. Analyzing it is a smaller part. So I believe personally that data management still remains very valid or very important in this world of data, right? So some of you probably read this the earlier paper by I think Google chief statistician Halvarian at that time. It was Peter Norvig, 2009 CSEM paper about unreasonable effectiveness of data. So 10 years after that, that paper was published, I think it was around last year, where another paper came out of Google, Abhinav Gupta published that from CMU, which is, does the promise of unreasonable effectiveness of data still exist in this deep learning AI kind of workloads, right? And the graph in here is extremely interesting, right? Basically says that when you train your models on larger and larger amounts of data, your effectiveness of the model increases. All of us know that, right? However, if you look at that, it's basically the x-axis is actually on the log scale. Y-axis is linear, right? So you have to increase your data sizes for training your data, and this is relevant data sizes, for training your model an order of magnitude more in order to get a linear scalability or linear speed up or linear efficacy of your models, right? So what does this mean? The big data, I mean, again, the hype of big data has sort of, people say that it has started going down, but the big data is still relevant and still important in this world driven by AI. And in fact, for the deep learning things, the deep learning models, you in fact need an order of magnitude bigger data in order to improve these models, right? So why are people not excited about Hadoop for processing this big data now, right? Again, I'm not talking about the west of Sacramento crowd. I'm talking about the east of Sacramento crowd, right? Okay. So then people basically say, okay, then what is Hadoop these days, right? So my attempt to define Hadoop with Gartner and the usual Twitter wars about what is Hadoop, only one thing is changed here, right? And that one is basically put AI on top of that, right? So what is Hadoop? Well, it is a reference implementation of the standard APIs. The open source basically creates standardized APIs. That's essentially what has happened. One of the projects that I had launched I had participated in the launch of that project in my previous company, EMC Greenplum, was with a storage division in there called Isilon. That was the first commercially supported Hadoop compatible file system on a proprietary hardware, right? In a proprietary system. So we have basically now seen that a lot of file systems, proprietary or open source, have started Hadoop compatible file system APIs, right? So essentially Hadoop file system APIs have become standardized and people have started implementing them. What I see happening, and some of these conversations are under NDA with some of our partners, et cetera, but what I see happening is the YARN APIs themselves are also getting cloned and being supported by other vendors. Okay, so what is happening there? First, the new Hadoop that is emerging, at least in the enterprise, with this cloud focus, has a compute storage separation, right? So that is a given, that is going to happen, and that is already happening, right? The computes in this Hadoop are based on containers, and the orchestration layer is separate, right? So really what is happening, based on all the conversations that I've been having with the vendors in this space, is the same way that the HDFS APIs were taken and became standard over other storage systems, whether object stores or other file systems, etc. What is happening is the YAN APIs are getting standardized or being used as a standard and being provided as an API shim layer on top of existing container orchestrations, as well as isolation layers, as well as scheduling layers, etc., etc. So rather than having a single system that basically provides resource allocation, management, scheduling, resource isolation at a node level, etc., etc., we are going towards 4 or 5 different components coming together, but they are all providing YAN compatible APIs so that the workloads that are currently using YAN as a resource manager and for everything, those will be able to easily migrate to those new platforms. We have started seeing the force behind Kubernetes. Obviously, if you don't interoperate with Kubernetes, apparently you don't have a future. That's what I've been hearing, right? However, in order to operate that, you need to logically separate your computations from the storage layer, right? And because the state management is extremely difficult when you have these, you know, containers coming in and going out, etc. Right? So the storage is separated. The storage is has not had a major change in the last 5 years or so. The one change that I have seen happening is basically a tiered storage with a deeper tiering hierarchy, right? We basically started seeing object stores obviously have become ubiquitous now, distributed file systems to be implemented on top of object stores rather than object stores being implemented on top of distributed file system. That's one change that we have seen because of the persistent volumes that you need to provide for your Dockers and your Kubernetes pods, etc. But the third thing that is happening is people have started looking at their data sets with a higher level abstractions, right, rather than at the file, block, or object level, right? Various reasons for that. Obviously, SQL has become the lingua franca again of the data processing world, and therefore people tend to think in terms of tables, foreign key relationships, all these things, even for so-called unstructured data sets, right? When you are trying to do ML on top of any of these unstructured data sets, you are first extracting the features out of that. And hey, guess what? Those features vectors are actually fairly structured or semi-structured, right? That's what we operate on. And therefore, people have started operating on a higher level of abstraction, right? And the final one that we have started seeing, especially after the last few years of consolidation, where the memory cost remained the same, now we have basically started seeing memory cost have again started to decline about 25% year over year, as it was prior to this consolidation started happening. So large, very dense memories as well as non-volatile memories have started to become economical and will become economical over the last 5 years. And this will be yet another tier, in my belief, this will be yet another tier in this entire storage hierarchy at this massive, massive scale, right? So that's basically what is happening. And, I believe the future of Hadoop in AI is really bright because that's where the data is, right? You only need to change what you call Hadoop. Apache Hadoop does not change, but what you call Hadoop in the market is changing, right? To address those AI requirements. That's pretty much what I had. Questions? Yes.
You said that the cloud had a very important role in disrupting Hadoop's future in 2014. How big do you think the impact of the appearances of some NoSQL databases like Cassandra or MongoDB was? I know the workload for them is not analytical, but maybe of the graph ones as well, which sometimes it's analytical.
Yeah. So I think Hadoop was unfairly being clubbed together with this NoSQL umbrella, right? When people really talked about NoSQL, it was all get put kind of workloads, right? I mean, scalable, yes. I mean, commodity hardware, local storage, and scalable infrastructure was the only common thing among Hadoop and Cassandra. The workloads were very different, right? HBase did try to basically use Hadoop or HDFS in particular as a storage layer, but really that, you know, combination of analytical and transactional, quote-unquote transactional workloads, it has been touted for a long time that HTAP is going to emerge, but that is not happening as fast as we would like it to happen, right? So yes, the two silos still got created, one for transactional, one for analytical, but each one of those basically handled more and more non-structured data, I would say, right? So Hadoop, I think Cassandra and Mongo, et cetera, haven't had a major impact on the Hadoop as a project or Hadoop analytical ecosystem as such, right? Yeah.